334, please. Hymn number 334. Would you stand with us as we sing, "This is my story, this is my soul"?
This is my story. This is my song. Father God, we do come before you this morning to praise you. And Father, we thank you that you do remain the same yesterday, today, and forever. Father, we praise you for that. We thank you, Father, that you're here with us right now. Father, we thank you for this time that we have to come to worship you. My prayer this morning, Father, is that now you would prepare our hearts as we sing, as we pray, and as later on we remember what Christ has done for us through his death on the cross and his burial and resurrection. Father, we pray that all this will bring glory and honor to you. Father, I pray that this morning we will be prepared to worship you as our lives will be a living sacrifice unto you. Father, if there's anything in our lives this morning, anything that would hinder us from worshiping you or serving you, Father, my prayer is that right now in our heart of hearts, we would confess that sin, knowing full well that you would forgive us and renew that right relationship with you. So, Father, I thank you for this time we have together. We lift up those of our church, Father, who are not with us this morning, maybe due to illness, those in the hospitals, others who are recovering at home, some who've lost loved ones. Father, for all of these, we pray that you would be with them, strengthen them, and encourage them. And now, Father, we turn our hearts to you. Father, we give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. So we pray these things in Jesus' precious, his wonderful, and his powerful name.
I will not dread. I will not fear.
so much. Hymn number four, please. Hymn number four in your hymnal. May we turn to that. For to God be the glory. Great things he has done. Would you stand up? Fellowship with one another. So if you will, introduce yourself and be introduced around our sanctuary at this time.
Once again, we thank you for being in our house today. Thank you for this beautiful day. Pray for those who cannot be here for whatever reason, illness or in the hospital or whatever, Lord, on vacations or whatever. But, Lord, we pray that you would be with those, bring them back safely to be in our house again. Lord, as we come before thee at this time to give back a little bit of what thou hast given us, Lord, we pray, Lord, that you just bless these tithes and offerings, Lord, and help us to give of a free, loving spirit, Lord, and not begrudge it, because we know that you don't have to have anything we have, but we want to give it back to thee because we love thee, Lord, and we love to work for thee, Lord, and do thy work. Pray, Lord, you continue to watch over us, lead us, guard, guide, direct us in everything we do and say, Lord, and bring us back again to our house to worship thee and serve thee. Thank you.
Remember, in Genesis, God promised the man named Abram first to have a son, that he would give him a son. And then he made a covenant or an agreement with Abraham, the as he changed his name to, that he would be the father of a great nation, a great people, and he would give them a land, the land of Canaan, as their possession. And in Exodus 6, verses 2 through 6, verse 8, God repeats what we call the Abrahamic covenant. And I'd like to read that to you. If you would like to, you can turn to Exodus 6, verses 2 through 6 and verse 8. You might want to leave your Bibles open. There will be a few different passages that I'll read to you this morning. But in Exodus 6, God says unto Moses, and he says, I am the Lord, and I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob by the name of God Almighty, but by my name Jehovah was I not known to them. And I have also established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan, the land of their pilgrimage, wherein they were strangers. And I have also heard the groaning of the children of Israel, whom the Egyptians keep in bondage, and I have remembered my covenant. Wherefore say unto the children of Israel, I am the Lord, and I will bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians, and I will rid you out of their bondage, and I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with great judgments. And then in verse 8, and I will bring you into the land concerning which I did swear to give to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, and I will give it to you for a heritage. I am the Lord. And just as a point of interest, just to let you know, if you don't already know, but in a nutshell, all the problems that we see in the Middle East concerning Israel and the Arab nations go back to this promise that God made to the people of Israel. See, Israel has a claim on the land because God told them that it was their land. Of course, all the Arab nations say, no, that was their land. This has been going on for thousands of years. Read on to Revelation, you'll know that there will never be a peace. And if you hear of one, it's just going to be a false peace, because there will never be peace, because neither one is willing to give up what they fiercely believe is their own land. But that's just an aside. That's not what I want to talk to you about this morning. What I want to begin with is to let you know that this past Friday I was in Atlanta for the 1996 Olympics. And after the morning's event that I attended, I was downtown in Atlanta, and I was standing on International Street. And as far as the eye could see in one direction was just a mass of humanity. I can't begin to tell you what it was like to see just a sea of people as far as I could see in one direction. And then I turned, looked down the other end of the street, and as far up the hill as you could see was just a mass of humanity. And that was on one street. I know if I'd gone up to Peachtree and looked in both directions, I would have seen the same thing. If I was over by the Georgia Dome, I would have seen the same thing. If I was at one of the other venues, like the Atlanta Fulton County Stadium or the Olympic Stadium, which I was earlier that morning, it was the same thing wherever you went. That night when we left to get on the subway system, the same thing. The subway escalators were just full of people. They were just wall to wall. I tell you, it was, well, there's no way to explain it unless you can see it for yourself. But it reminded me that in the month of Nisan, the 14th day, in the year 3790, many, many thousands of more people were in Jerusalem than I know were in Atlanta this past Friday. It just boggles the imagination to know that many people were in one place at one time to worship God and to be obedient to a command that Moses had given the people many years before. On that day at twilight, the disciples, as with all the other people in Jerusalem, were gathering in their homes or other places where they would meet. And that day earlier, or earlier actually 4 days earlier from that, every household had an unblemished lamb that they were preparing for this day, when they were to take it to the temple, and the gates would be opened, and the people would have to be, would come in divisions, three divisions of thousands. And they'd have to come in that because even as massive as the temple courts were, it could not hold all the people, so they had to come in three different divisions. And the head of the household would bring the lamb in, and there would be priests lined up all across the courtyard. And one priest for each person that came forward would cut the throat of this unblemished, under 1 year old lamb, innocent lamb, and bleed that blood while another priest held a bow to capture the blood, and then take it back. And then, of course, they took the skin off, and they wrapped the lamb in the skin. And they did this for everyone. And then that night, everyone went carrying their precious lamb wrapped in the lambskin to their homes to prepare for what was called the Passover Seder. Well, on this night, 12 disciples were gathered in an upper room with Jesus. And you have to remember what they were commemorating here. They were commemorating what was promised to them by God to Abraham when he told the people, you will be in bondage in another land for 400 years. But after that time, I will come and I will deliver you and I will bring you into a promised land, a new land, that I will give you for your possession. So this was promised before Moses came on the scene, but the prophecy was fulfilled with Moses leading the people out of Egypt. Now in a minute, I will read that story to you. But on this night, I want you to realize that what you had was not 12 Christians who were coming to consecrate a new sacrament that we would do from that day hence. That's not what we had at all. What we had was 12 fiercely, deeply devoted Jewish men. And they were coming to commemorate what to them was one of the most special things to them in their whole religion. And out of the three main feasts that they celebrated, this was the Passover feast. And this was like the bedrock of what they believed in. And yet, this night, it would forevermore be changed for them. It began first first of four cups of wine that would be taken during that Seder meal. Jesus himself took the first cup and he said, "Blessed art thou, Jehovah our God, who has created the first fruit of the vine." And instead of going on with the liturgy that he was to say, he said, "I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. Take this and share it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine from now on until that day that I drink it with you in my Father's kingdom." Then, later on in the meal, was the first, what would be called the appetizer. It was bitter herbs wrapped in unleavened bread. And then Jesus did something different with this. He kind of shocked the disciples by telling them that the person who took this herb would betray him that very night. Everyone was looking at each other, and John finally whispered to Jesus, "Who is that?" Jesus gave that bitter herb wrapped in unleavened bread to Judas. And Judas said, "Surely not I, Lord." And Jesus said, "You said it yourself. Go, and what you do, do quickly." And then Judas left. And then they were able to continue the Paschal meal. And let me pause just right now to say that already the disciples, who remember now are deeply devoted Jews, have already kind of had their whole world shaken just by the words of Jesus. Because they were coming to hear the liturgy that they had heard each year of their lives, from the time of little children. They could they could repeat the liturgy themselves. And this was so very important to them. And yet here Jesus began very early on and began to change the liturgy. And that was something you didn't do. You just didn't meddle with this liturgy that had been handed down generation after generation after generation. So you can understand the disciples, what maybe was going on in their minds right now. I know one thing is that they had a hard time understanding the full meaning behind all the symbolism that was already in the Seder, but certainly what Jesus was trying to bring to fulfillment that evening. According to tradition, the youngest present at the Seder meal was to ask the host some traditional questions. Philip, being the youngest of the disciples, asked this question: "Master, why is it this night is different from all other nights?" Then, according to tradition, the host was to tell the story of the first Passover, the story, again, which every Jew knew by heart. And the story began in slavery. And if you'll turn over in Exodus, just a few chapters to chapter 11. Really, with chapter 12, I'll start in verses 9 and 10 of 11. When Philip asked Jesus, this is what Jesus began to tell the disciples. "The Lord said to Moses, 'Pharaoh will refuse to listen to you so that many wonders may be multiplied in Egypt.' Moses and Aaron performed all these wonders before Pharaoh, but the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he would not let the Israelites go out of his country. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in Egypt, 'This month is to be for you the first month of your year. Tell the whole community of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, each man is to take a lamb for his family, one for each household. Any household is too small for a whole lamb, they must share one with their nearest neighbor, having taken into account the number of people there are.' Now, they could be from anywhere from at least 10 to not more than 20 people to a household. You are to determine the amount of lamb needed in accordance with that what each person will eat. The animals you choose must be a year old males without defect, and you may take them from the sheep or the goats. Take care of them until the 14th day of the month, when all the people of the community of Israel must slaughter them at twilight. Then they are to take some of the blood and put it on the sides and tops of the door frames of the houses where they eat the lambs. That same night they are to eat the meat roasted over the fire, along with bitter herbs and bread made without yeast. Do not eat the meat raw or cooked in water, but roast it over the fire, head, legs, and inner parts. Do not leave any of it till morning. If some is left till morning, you must burn it. This is how you are to eat it: with your cloak tucked into your belt, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. Eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. On that same night I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn, both men and animals, and I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord. The blood will be a sign for you on the houses where you are, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you. No destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt." In Egypt, the price of redemption was the life of an unblemished lamb. But soon, on this to happen, a more precious lamb would be sacrificed. And Jesus took the bread and blessed it, and he said, "Praise thee, thou God, our Lord, King of the world, who causes bread to come forth from the earth." And then he said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And they did just as he said, and like so many times before, they didn't fully understand what they were doing. And later on, there's another cup that is passed, and then there's the eating of the Paschal lamb. And then I'd like to read to you the third cup, which is called the cup of redemption. This cup represents the third, I will redeem you. This is God's promise that he would redeem his people from slavery, meaning he would buy them back. This is this cup after supper in the upper room, which Jesus raised and stated, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. This cup that represents the new covenant is the cup of redemption. It is the cup after the supper which our Messiah used to symbolize his death. The scriptures tell us that without the shedding of blood, there can be no remission of sin. And that's in Hebrews 9:22. And then in Leviticus 17:11, it says that the life of the flesh is in the blood. When one is wounded, the blood forms a covering over the wound and permits the healing of the body. It keeps out infection and disease. If the covering is removed or damaged, the wound may become infected, and infection without cure can ultimately kill the body. The scripture then tells us when God placed man and woman in the garden, they rebelled and sinned. Like an ugly wound, sin cut the fellowship between God and man. God in his holiness and righteousness no longer could have fellowship with a sinful, rebellious man. Man in his rebellion and sin and pride would not seek to have fellowship with God. Covering for that wound had to be made. So God in his mercy and love chose Israel. And to Israel he committed the sacrifices, the offerings, the Torah. God told Israel that he would allow them through the blood of the bulls and the goats, the sacrifices, to make an atonement or a covering for their sin. It would cover over the ugly wound and permit healing and fellowship. But Israel would not leave the covering alone. Instead of obeying God and following his instructions, they sought to cover sin in their own way. The infection of sin spread through the nation and would ultimately have destroyed them had God not intervened. Once again, in his grace and mercy, and in the fulfillment of his word, he sent his son, the Messiah, Yeshua, Jesus, to die in our place. The prophet Isaiah wrote, "But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. Punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." Messiah's death, God did not just cover sin, he took sin away. Anyone who accepts Messiah's death and accepts him as their Lord and Savior has passed from death into life. God has forgiven their sins. He has cleansed them from all unrighteousness. Our Messiah came, he died, shedding his blood even as the Passover lamb of old to provide for all who will place their faith and their trust in him, redemption from sin. Thank you. I didn't go through the whole Seder meal step by step. That would have taken way too long. But in the Seder meal, there's a time when the bread is broken. And for all the years that it was celebrated up to the time of this night before Jesus went to the cross, no one really understood what it meant. If you know what Scripture says, it says that not a bone of his body was broken. But yet Jesus said, take this body which is broken for you. And later on, the disciples, maybe not that night, but since then have realized that when you break that bread in the Seder service, it is showing the death, the sacrifice that Christ made. Let us pray. Father God, we come before you and we just thank you, Father, for this time that we can come and worship you. Father, as we look back in Scripture and Father, as we see from the very beginning the Passover meal and the significance of that, and Father, how for we as believers can see in looking back that Christ was in all of that meal. And Father, that he was prophesied. That his coming and that his death and his burial and his resurrection was all promised within the meal that your chosen people had for so many years taken but not fully understood. Father, we thank you that we can understand what Christ has done for us and that his body was beaten for us and that he suffered greatly and that his body was broken as far as his life. Death for us. Father, we thank you for that. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. Thank you. As I shared earlier about the Passover lamb, and Scripture tells us that Jesus Christ is our Passover lamb. Finally, God was able to provide a sacrifice for us, whereas we could never do it for ourselves. Where nothing, all the lambs, all the millions and millions of lambs that were slain in history could not remove that stain of sin from our lives. But the one supreme sacrifice, the unblemished lamb, the Son of God. The Son of God. He died for us, and his blood cleanses us from all our sin. Father God, I just want to thank you for loving us enough that even when in our sin and our separation from you, we were so far removed, that you loved us enough to give your only Son to suffer and to die for us. Father, I thank you that Jesus Christ was willing to take my place on the cross. Father, how precious is that blood that was spilled for me. Father, I pray that as we take this cup, that we will remember all that he has done for us. And that in turn, Father, we will bring glory to him by the way we live our lives. I pray these things in his name, the name of Jesus. After the same manner also, he took the cup. When he had supped, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Paul says, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do proclaim the Lord's death till he come." After every Seder service, they closed with a song of praise. We're going to close with a song of invitation. If you have never trusted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior for what he did for you on the cross, this is an opportunity for you to come at this time. If you would like to come and join this church by letter, if you're coming from another denomination, we invite you to come now. If you just wish to come and pray at the altar, but whatever decision God calls you to make this morning, as we sing the song, "Just As I Am," remember that he takes you just as you are right now, and he can make you whole, and he can make you clean through his shed blood. Let us sing.
Just as be seated. Katie Corum comes by profession of faith. In fact, she just prayed to receive Christ right here. She said, I want to ask Jesus Christ to come into my heart, my life, and I want to be saved and go to heaven. And that's just exactly what she did. And so we are happy with Katie and her decision, and we're going to talk more with her and then set a date for baptism. So we rejoice, Katie, in the decision that you've made this morning. I appreciate your being here. I always tell Brother Mike, whenever you leave, please don't announce it. But he still does that. So, but I am thankful that you're here with us this morning. I hope this has been a meaningful time of remembrance of the Lord's Supper for you. It's not something that we just do once in a while. It's something that has meaning. Just as much meaning as the Seder service had for the Jewish people, the Lord's Supper ought to have more meaning for us than what Jesus Christ has done for you and for me. I believe we are going to close with a fellowship song. I guess since she first came to this church, maybe they were here before me. I can't remember that far back, but I've known her for, I know, the last 6.5 years and watched her grow up. She's 7 years old, so I've known her most of her life. And it was my privilege to share with her after she walked the aisle and just talk with her about her decision to follow Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. And even though at the age of 7, there's a lot of things she doesn't understand, just as there's a lot of things I do not understand, the one thing that Claire knows is that she's invited Jesus Christ into her heart and to her life, and that she knows that she has a home in heaven one day, and that he is the Lord of her life, and he has saved her. And that's what counts. And so she wants to be obedient to Christ in the area of baptism, and that's why she's here tonight. She's been excited about this and looking forward to it. Claire, in the early church, prior to being baptized, believers were asked a question: who is your Lord? I ask you the question, who is your Lord? Amen. Declare upon your confession of faith that Jesus Christ is your Lord. And in obedience to his divine command, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with him in baptism, rise to walk in newness of life. Let us pray. Father God, I just want to thank you once again for another person who has come to be baptized, to be obedient in baptism. Father, we thank you for Claire, for the decision that she's already made to trust Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. I thank you for her family and for her Sunday school teachers and for others in her life, Father, who have influenced her and who have shared with her about Jesus. And thank you most of all, Father, that your Holy Spirit reached down and touched her heart and touched her life, and that she was receptive to your call. So, Father, I just pray that if there's someone tonight in this place who has never really received Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, Father, even now your Holy Spirit is speaking to them, and that when you call, Father, they will respond. I thank you for our men, the men in this church, and for the various ministries. Father, as they lead out in worship tonight, I pray that you would bless them and use them in a mighty way. Father, may we all now turn our hearts and our eyes and our ears to you. Father, we pray that above all else tonight, Jesus Christ might be lifted up and that he might be glorified. We pray all these things in the precious, the wonderful, and the powerful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you.
to Eastmont Baptist Church. We're glad to have you here tonight. The service obviously is going to be a little bit different than you're accustomed to, and a little bit different than I'm accustomed to. I'm used to being out there. It's kind of hot under the lights, hot under the collar. We aren't going to have an offertory tonight where we pass the plate, so as you pass by the plate in the vestibule on your way out after the service, if you do have an offering that you want to give, please put it in the plate at that time. The service tonight, as you'll see with the handout, that there's an order that we're going to follow, and each man will come.